are super enthusiastic. They just jump in when they watch me and do that sound effect.
Okay. So my name is Tina Wilson, and I'm a grad student in the School of Social Work at MAC. And we're talking with John Clark about an intro chapter to a not-yet-published book. And this is part of the School of Social Work's 50th anniversary here at McMaster University. To mark where this came from. So you're not yet sure of the name of your new book.
I want it to be called Critical Dialogue. And we might call it that, but then we're in long, drawn-out negotiations about all the words that might go into the subtitle.
Oh, jeez, okay.
Like, I want it to be talking about thinking, thinking about talking, but my editor thinks it might be more interesting than that.
Okay. You used to do a Buckingham
Bridge
magnet poetry?
That sort of thing. Yeah. That's what we're looking to.
Okay.
So, suggestions gratefully received.
Okay, very cool. So then the piece that the folks in the room have read is the introductory chapter to Critical Dialogues, and the name of the first chapter is Voices in My Head, Thinking Critically as Dialogical Practice. So dialogical practice as method, which I think is so the forthcoming book project presents edited conversations between yourself and a series of super fancy smarty pants who've been kicking around for a long time and have sort of shaped a lot of stuff, actually, in terms of social theory. But in social work, we'd probably be most familiar with Wendy Brown, Wendy Lerner, Janet Newman, and Larry Grossberg as well. We probably would be those that are more common. So I'm going to attempt to summarize what I think that you're attempting to do in the book project that I haven't read, but just the introduction. So my read of it is that in the chapter you're raising concern for how the academy individualizes insight, and perhaps relatedly, you don't say this explicitly necessarily, but encourages a hermeneutics of suspicion that teaches us to read to dismiss, and to read to find a benchmark against to register ourselves as an improvement. So the tyranny of the new, and the genre requirements of academic scholarship that mean that you always have to be an improvement, you always have to be new, in some ways is a sort of structures that they say, I say, sort of benchmarking. So as an intervention then, the book demonstrates through conversations with all these fantastic famous folks, the relational, intersubjective, and unfinished nature of thinking. So as you say in the subtitle to your chapter, thinking critically as dialogical. So I suspect, but the book's not done, so I couldn't have read it yet, that the project demonstrates the recursive circulation of ideas across times and places as a means to illustrate the shared articulating and re-articulating nature of thinking, such that the very notion of individual ownership of ideas becomes at least partially untenable. So if that suspicion is right, then the illustration that the book is, or the intervention that the book is it's a means to demystify the ordinary, the everyday, lived practice of muddling through in good company. That was my take on the book.
I like muddling through in good company. Okay. I have a slight preference for the phrase making things up. Because I do think it's a phrase that I throw in and out with a number of friends. And it's been used as a way of talking about the work of cultural studies has always been provisionally making things up. That when we were students, there wasn't a cultural studies to inherit, so there was a sense of both making up the topics, the ways of doing it, and arguing about it. I mean, arguing in that sense of arguing with and against each other. So, muddling I like, because it captures my experience of trying to pretend to be a coherent intellectual, but knowing that whatever it sounds like, it doesn't feel like that.
And you're showing that too. It felt like an intergenerational project, like you had a sense of, like, this is the state of things, this is how things are looking out. And I know from my scholarly generation, a lot of our critical theory is inherited from American cultural studies, which is fine. Like, it's fantastic work, but it means that we're missing the history that actually came with it, or that it was benchmarked against itself. So there's a loss of history and a loss of memory. So to inherit, essentially, a Caroline critique of just how bad things are without having a sense of the history of the conversations that were happening. So then the book feels like an intervention. Like, no, this is long-term stuff. None of the stuff is new. We've been arguing about this stuff. We've been thinking about this stuff. That the language just changes over time in a way that it's harder to say, perhaps, I don't know, in the academy today, because the pressure to constantly sort of center your eye and to know things and to be an improvement. And in some ways, the easiest way to do that is doing more history, especially the recent history.
I think that's true. And I think, I mean, that's doubled by what we old Marxists would call the crisis of overproduction, which is, it's not just the pressure to be new, it's the pressure to keep up with an endlessly new. That that if you're going to say anything, at least people have produced, about 10 people have produced books or articles between me starting that sentence and me finishing it. So there's always something to be engaged with. And that seems to me, and it's not that it's entirely new, but there's an intensity of it. The number of journals multiplies, the number of, the number of PhD students multiply, the number of books that people feel obliged to write multiplies, and. And that's partly because it's a more fetishized and competitive environment in which to be working.
But isn't it also our culture, in broad sense? I mean, you're always trying to invent something new. You know, I remember reading Miles Davis' biography. He was obsessed that his next album be different from his last one. Lack of contentment.
I do think that's true. You're right. More generally, which is, I'm going to qualify it in a moment, but it's right more generally because there is a sense in which, if you don't have anything new to say, you should probably not be saying anything. Or at least you should acknowledge that you're saying it again. So if you are going to hear me more than once this week, you will know the dilemma of Paul Gilroy uses anyway, a phrase that he calls the changing same. And I have this suspicion that my week in Hamilton will be an experience of the changing same. Some of the stories may, if you're lucky, alter, but some of them may not. And then there's the qualification. And the qualification is this. Academics in the fetishized production of knowledge have become incredibly skilled at repackaging the thing that they knew as if it is new. And there are some of my colleagues out there in the world, I will not name names, who I think, but I'm sure I've read that before. And I'm sure that some of them were thinking about me. You know, if people read the things that I've been writing post-Brexit, they will say, oh no, it's Clark on conjunctural analysis again. Oh! And that's true. So there's some things that you might need, but if it doesn't...
But doesn't change incremental? I mean, no one... You know, Thomas Edison didn't wake up one morning and invent a light bulb. It was a process.
Are you telling me this is a truth? No, look, you're shattering my illusion that Thomas Edison must have woken up one morning and thought, what I really need in my life is a light bulb. I'm going to stub my toe trying to get out of bed again. I think it's a proposition, but I think it's not a truth. Change is sometimes incremental, and it's sometimes disconcertingly radical and transformative, sometimes progressively, and quite often not. And so I don't want to think that there's only one register for change. I want to think the one thing I'm sure about is that I won't know what form it takes next time around.
That bed tax story you told, I mean, that is just unbelievable.
We are, and my government, as I swear to refer to them, is incredibly creative. And being creative and bringing about change is not necessarily an improvement to the human condition.
Are you finding in more spaces in academia that that folks are looking for theories of complexity that aren't sort of founded on poles or coherent poles? So articulation theory is being able to change scales, like just the more sort of mobile, sort of time-specific, nimble, looking at like ideology material, like rolling it all and paying attention to what needs to be.
Can I have two answers to the question? One is, well, and they're yes and no answers. The yes answer is absolutely. And there is a proliferation of theories of relational analysis, of contingency, of specificities, and whether it's about assemblage or articulation, or becoming, or there's an attention to the making of a moment, and how multiple and fragile that might be. Okay, that's answer number one. Answer number two is, and yet, how would you account for the massive influence of structural political economy? Which seems to me to have undergone a revival alongside, as neoliberalism's evil twin, whichever way around you want that one, because there is a need to account for not the fragile and contingent, but the massive and weightily structural. And I have, because I believe in dialogue, I have long-running conversations with people I work with about how on earth do you reconcile those two desires, you know. So when we were finishing the book on making policy move, you know, we were sitting in a cafe having an argument about, well, we've been very good about, you know, translation and assemblage and articulation, and, you know, things change as they move and are changed, and there's a sort of agency in translation. But what if somebody asks us to account for how grim and structurally similar the world feels? Because there's all these complicated processes and they end up looking unnervingly similar. And that seems to me to be a tough... I'm waving my hands because I think it's the... you know, it's where the difficulty is, right? Because I read, how widely is this going to be circulated? I read some structural political economists, and I think, because it's so solid, right? The analysis of the world is so solid that I have been known to say, in that case, I'm giving up and going shopping. Because we have lost, right? So, capital one, neoliberalism rules, and it's all over. And I think there must be more to life, as it were, than that. And that's not just a matter of adding a footnote or a last paragraph which says, adject resistance is possible. Well, but nowhere in your analysis is resistance possible. That's why I keep on thinking, because I think all of that is as yet unresolved.
Do you really think resistance is possible?
Yes. That was easy, wasn't it?
Yeah. Very clear.
I do think, I think a whole set of things are possible. And that's because I, to the extent that I am an old Marxist, I'm an old Marxist whose Marxism contained the word contradictions. And I think a lot of structural political economy appears contradiction-free. So it works. And I'm interested in actually liking the talk. I am actually interested in the fact that it doesn't work. And that creates spaces and it's fractures and fissures in the moment.
But even though
to me, that means resistance is almost inevitable. It may not be successful,
mm-hmm.
but it will inevitably try to emerge and then be co-opted.
And I'm going to say yes and no, because that's what I do all the time. Mm. And yes, I think it's almost inevitable, isn't it? Quite, because you don't want to rely on the fact mm-hmm. that it will. But it's also that I think we may over-compress things into resistance, right? That are more than that. So I think, I think there's activism, which is, conscious mobilizations, purposive, reflexive. Then there's resistance, which is in the range from intransigence to when I was a baby cultural studies person, we talked about subcultural practices as magical resolutions that resolved problems and contradictions, but in the symbolic rather than in reality. But my favourite word for the last couple of years has been recalcitrance, and I think lots of systemic processes generate recalcitrance. And I view recalcitrance as this position, which is no.
Mm-hmm. So
I don't care. I don't care. I'm not going to do it. Mm-hmm. I don't care how much you tell me I ought to. I am not moving. No, I'm not going. No, I'm not going. And I just think there's a lot of stubbornnesses and refusals. Grudging compliance, and so I think there's a whole repertoire of things that we ought to be attentive to.
Resistance, and I guess I was just thinking, but I mean, I think the thing about resistance is it is a highly contradictory practice. Like, it's not straightforward. It's complex and it's contradictory and. And those of us engaged in it have multiple attachments to multiple things. And mm-hmm. I think, I mean, that's both exciting, but problematic, in a sense of moving a story or a project forward. Like, it's just so fluid, I think is the word, or in my mind, to some extent.
I think you're right. And my reaction is, instead of going for yes or no, I'm going for three different things. So the first is, and what's not? I think that's one of the reasons why I think there's the interesting complexity and contingency and multiplicity and becoming is right, because it just feels like life. Never mind an analytics problem. It feels like life. All of my life feels a bit flaky and messy and complicated, and the bits don't quite join up in the way that I would like them to. Fine. So then the second is, and then there's an analytical problem about how one goes about making sense of that. And there are choices there about where, as it were, in the range of complexity to, well, but you can pick out the big things and concentrate.
Second story.
But the third bit is the hard one, you see, because the first one is simple truth. The second one is, well, you have to make choices. But the third one is, politically, then, it's a question about how you choose to connect things. You can concentrate on one thing, or you can look for the possible junctions and connections, or you can do can do political knitting, and you know, complex connections can be made. But those are, I mean, they're not just individual things, they're political calculations. But they're not quite given by either the simple truth about life is complicated,
right,
nor the analytic framing. There are still political calculations and choices. Calculations is such an ugly word. Political
strategy.
Yes, it's, well, a strategy and tactics, because, yeah. I mean, knitting is both. Like,
But
though I've never tried to make this concept work, knitting is both a strategy and a tactic. That would be right. It is both a pattern and a actual articulation of the strands of wool. But you can tell that I don't knit, so this is going to go badly wrong.
Neither do I. But in your lecture, you talked about the failure of capitalism in 2008. And the response to it was to be better capitalists. Because, you know, when you're in economics class, if something goes awry, well, the answer is always, well, it's not a perfectly competitive market. So, if capitalism was better, so we're not, we really shouldn't be changing capitalism, we should just be making capitalism better. That's always been the response. So given that response, how is there a public resistance?
Oh, I think because on the one hand, you can only say a lie so many times before at least some people stop believing it. And the fact that it's taught in economics classes has become less and less the basis for people believing it, it seems to me. So there is a growing interest within economics in heterodox economics. There are campaigns to have economics taught differently, driven by economics students who can't stand it. But there are, in the wider public realm, there's I think there's always been a degree of skepticism. I don't think it's new. I think people have long been skeptical about the promise that it will work next time. But I think there's a growing, I think that's growing and is more visible, audible, more tangible. As a, well, that's what they said in 2008, that's what they said in 1977, that's what they said in 1932, that's what they said in 1883. Do you think they're ever going to crack this one? To which the answer is, yeah. And so that solidifies a bit. Should I stop talking now? I know you want to say something. Should I stop talking now?
No, not at all. You're just making me think about other things. And I wanted to come back to this idea that we were talking about with resistance before, and speaking about dialogue. Tori and I, in advance of talking to you, had a dialogue yesterday about things that we've noticed from your articles and writings that we thought were really interesting. So my area of interest is really precarious work, and I think that this is sort of another thing that's coming out of what Russ was talking about, the disintegration of capitalism in this way, or the amplification, however you want to say it. And in your work, you talked about how political movements and interests groups were sort of garnering attention in the public space increasingly, and I was wondering if you could sort of speak to some of those, like the precariat movement in Italy, and how those spaces for resistance might become new states of imagining or new possibilities that come out of those.
There's a danger here, right, which is I could speak about them, and it would be at risk of me making stuff up.
Sure.
So I'm going to try and be a bit more self-disciplined and careful about this.
Okay.
Which is, I know about third hand.
Right.
That there are different movements which overlap, don't always bump into one another, but might. So there's contingent work, precariat movements in Italy and elsewhere, which attempt to create new solidarities. If you take Italy as an interesting space, there are also migrant solidarity movements, especially in the South, given the Lega Nord driven backlash against the Mediterranean crossing. So, but they don't necessarily join up. Though there are points at which you think, I think, not you think, I shouldn't project this onto you, wouldn't it be interesting, and you could see that different sorts of precariousness or different sorts of contingency are in play in shaping these places and experiences. And I think one of the interesting, I think, I am making it up, okay? So I think precarity got too quickly colonized by the precarious labor question. Because it does seem to me that it has a wider resonance now. And so places are precarious.
Yes.
Now live in Syria just at the moment, you know, or in some deindustrialized space like my parents lived in, I grew up in, right? They are different sorts. I mean, I don't think Sheffield and Syria are the same precarity, but they have a precariousness of life and existence. And in the same way, the Mediterranean movement, it seems to me, both is driven by forms of precarity and generates, I mean, on a daily basis, you know, experiences of precarity. To get into those boats is, I mean, that's a offsetting for calculation. That is calculation. That is offsetting calculations about different sorts of being precarious in the hope that you might not be. So I just, there's a potential capaciousness about the notion of precariousness, precarity, precariousness. Interesting, I don't know which of those it should be. But which got, and I don't mean it's unreasonable, because this is what we do with words and ideas, got pulled into thinking about the changing forms, conditions and relations of wage labour. Yes, right, and absolutely. But I'd like to hear the echoes a bit more. So, because it hearing the echoes is also hearing the sites of potential solidarities. And that, I mean, I guess, to the extent that I have a rhetorical political interest, hearing the echoes and thinking what might be potentially generative of solidarities is important. And I say that because I think there is a depressing strand in political science which has spent two decades trying to set solidarity against difference. My mouth is closed, right? I'll leave you that little space.
Well, when we were talking yesterday, my conundrum was around the phenomenon of sort of, I guess it's called recognition theory or identity politics. And this is a beautiful source of plurality. And yet, the way it sometimes works out is it in almost a neoliberal form, where the special interests compete in neoliberal ways against other special interests. And the structural cause is never regarded or considered. And so the conundrum is how might, without losing the beautiful plurality, how might we simultaneously focus on what we have in common
Oh, you see, great conundrum. And the conundrum seems to me to be right, because I think your mapping of the possibilities and problems of that is really great. And one of the dangers is precisely the selective articulation of interests and identities. And so somebody just sent me to read, and it's one of those shame things that I'd not seen before, a wonderful piece of writing about hate crimes in the UK. And it's about the folding of lesbian, gay, queer communities into state protection and the construction of antagonisms around that, which is precisely to encourage and solicit and enroll the good queer citizen.
Yes, right.
Against all those other communities, especially in the UK at the moment, Muslim communities, because of their homophobia. And it is a delicate piece which traces the different, different entanglements and enrollments of some against requiring their others to be, well, to be policed, actually, by an intrusive and repressive state. So I think the diagnosis is right. I think and it's why I started with the political science thing, because I'm sick of reading, they are political scientists in the main, who tell me that a diverse public can't sustain welfare solidarities. And it operates with an astonishingly simple racializing thesis, which is people are different. And we only like people who are like us. Well, no, it won't do. It won't do empirically, because it's not true.
Yeah.
And it won't do historically, because there's lots of evidence that suggests it's not. And it won't do politically, because it has no conception of politics as a practice of mobilization and articulation. So, I sit and read this stuff, and it's always about, well, once upon a time, European social democracy was able to build strong welfare, solidaristic, strong welfare states. Yes. Sort of. There are questions about that. But now that migration has hit astonishingly high levels, these countries are becoming diverse, and they will become more like the United States of America. And the performed speechlessness here is that I don't know where to begin. Nowhere becomes like the United States, because nowhere has the history of formation of the United States, right? And as I read occasionally, Canadian political scientists say, and even just across the border, there are other variants of this process. Not entirely happy, not unproblematic, but not the United States. So, fine. But then I think that it misunderstands social democracy so badly. Because social democracy in its European form was built out of solidarities across difference.
Yes.
Yeah. You see, you can't have social democracy if you don't think that building solidarities between sections of the working class and sections of the middle class were possible. If it was a politics of difference, the middle class would have swanned off on its own, and the working class would have dug in on its own, and you wouldn't have had social democratic welfareism. So I start with the presumption that it's an articulated alliance. And now you're at the point of somebody, not you, but somebody wants to tell me, but that's not like the difference, is it? And you say, well, the race isn't quite as categoric as you seem to think it is. And some of the writing in the this not very nice literature about race and ethnicity is, it's as if the 1960s and 70s and 80s and 90s had never happened. It's like race theory. Right? People are different. Well, people are contingently different. And some differences matter, other more. And then, because of voices in my head, I'll stop maundering on and say, and fortunately, feminists that I know have taken the time to teach me about intersectionality. Mm-hmm. And people are not one identity. Even I am not one identity. I am quite complicated. And if my touchstone for social theory at the moment is, if I'm quite complicated, why would I not think other people won't? Right? And that presumes that I might have interests that connect across a whole series of things. But then you have to do the political work to make them materialise.
Well, when you talk about the European welfare state, the word that comes to mind is Greece. And I don't know a lot about Greece, but certainly in the North American media, it was a failure of the welfare state.
Yes. And where to begin? It turns out that there's a problem about welfare states. And it's a problem that turns me into an empiricist, right? Which is a really bad moment for me, because I don't know anything. So to be turned into an empiricist is sort of terrible. I know, and that view about Greece is not only North American, it's widespread in Western Europe. So, in terms of the concept of a European welfare state, Greece never had a welfare state. Right? It is what's sometimes called in the comparative social policy literature a Mediterranean welfare system. And Mediterranean welfare systems are profoundly underdeveloped. Though many of them have portable telephones. the Greece, Portugal, Spain, Italy, known collectively as the peaks. The southern Mediterranean. I'm going to put a real reference into this in a moment. We're all family-centred welfare regimes rather than developed welfare states. So that's one problem. The second is, there's a particular...
Sorry, I'm done.
there's a particular welfare issue in Greece which came to dominate everything, which was the pension question. And that's to do with the, not the welfare state, but the strange bureaucratic state apparatus that the Greek state did develop in a relatively conservative political period in Greece. So there's a thing about state bureaucracy and the consequences of building state bureaucracy. But the really great story that appears nowhere in either the European press or the North American media that I know about is the war debt. There's this one brilliant former finance minister who said, well, you do know that if Germany got round to paying the reparations that they were supposed to have paid after 45, it would have paid off all our debts and left us with a big surplus. So there's, I know about this because I was writing about time in conjunctural analysis. And it's very interesting because it disrupts the present calculation of Greek debt and places it internationally, in a proper transactional view, in unpaid debts. There's somewhere the Germans stole our money. So, the reason that I'm going on about pigs and the different welfare regimes is that there's a lovely book by an Italian-American literary theorist, cultural studies person, called Roberto Dianotto, and it's called Europe in Theory. And the book begins with talking about the pinks, and he says, and Europe, in this sense, always contains its other. The South, the global South, is already present in the form of the European South, because they're all lazy, they don't work hard enough, they don't have, you know, they don't have a Protestant disciplined family life, you know, they drink, they all, you know, they're all wine producing countries, they drink, and they have this relaxed southern relationship to the things that have made Europe great. And I think it's just a compelling piece of work, and it made me, this is really going on now, it made me think about the different Europe and its different peripheries, right? The places of Europe that are not really properly European. So there's the pigs, Mediterranean ring. There's us, because we don't really want to, you know, we don't really think of ourselves as European. But then there's, I have a friend who works in the former Yugoslavia, and there's a number of people work in that region on the way they are summoned to become European, but always fail because they're not really European. And then there's the Nordics, former slightly odd and much colder Europe, though more social democratic, I have to say. But so that Europe begins to have a sort of unnerving core of French, Germany, Benelux,
Switzerland.
Yeah. And then there's, I mean, because I work in Budapest, there's Central and Eastern Europe,
yes,
where you begin to draw the lines of difference. Because they are and are not. They are and they come and they go. And so the naming of Europe becomes one of the most politically troublesome. Stop me. It's your only chance.
But I think that this links to a whole bunch of stuff that you talked both in the talk and then also in the chapter around when ideas move and how they get translated into different contexts. So the romantic ideal of social democratic practice, let alone the German French influence in terms of social theory, but those ideas in settler colonies like America and Canada, would sort of articulate differently, but then the dream or the ideal of the collective that does actually come together, but it doesn't have the same history, doesn't have the same kind of relations of sociality, and aren't shaped by the same legal structures. Like my understanding of North America is that the only ways to make claims were through human rights claims or legal claims. So then, like, what does that do over 100 years? The only way you can actually argue for adequate citizenship is through legal claims.
Yeah.
And then how is that working out over time as a strategy? And what does that do in terms of the resources or the strategies that are available for people in negotiating their place in the world and for whatever group solidarities? So the idea of a sort of like an us that actually works together, and how that's so differently shaped. Like, it's so easy to be like, Europe is all one place. If you're not in Europe, like, it's really easy to do that. So it's almost like the stories that we, like the stories take on sort of a romantic, simplified lens as they travel a little bit. So just the loss of the specificity there, like how it's actually working.
I used to drive my colleagues and collaborators on course teams at the Open University crazy by saying, every time I saw the word we or us in one of their chapters, I would say, I know this is boring, could you just tell me who it is that you've got in mind?
Yeah.
And I became known as the, you know, the collective conscience of the course team. But it's imagine collectivities. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it would, you know, my colleagues would mean we as social scientists, we as authors, you know, but sometimes they'd mean we the British people, at which point you can feel it beginning to fall apart because my Scottish comrades would say, you know, it's a different legal system, don't you? You know, it's a different country, don't you? And why are we only writing about England? But sometimes it would be we, the human race. And you think, do you know, I might want to go more carefully than this. Yeah. We, how long do you have to be in a practicing we to share this history? Because there will be people reading this course who don't. So you might want to think about, it's not using the word, but locating it. Mm-hmm. Anyway, they hated me. And who could blame them? Because the word we appears a lot of time in academic writing.
Well, in your chapter, you make the argument to think with whom you're writing to, rather than thinking for them or to them. That sort of thing. And that struck me as a way of negotiating an imagined community of we. So I wonder if you could speak more about that.
I wonder if I could speak more about that. And I guess one of the things that the is the confluence of two influences. One of the things the Open University did for me was to make me worry, struggle about with, as a set of verbs that went badly wrong, how you teach if you can't see the people you're teaching, right? So here I am, you know, I can look at you, you can nod, or you can say, stop, you know, that's just, dear God, that's just stupid, or, so then, you know, it's not that these are power-free zones, it's not that they're unproblematic, but they are reactive. And you can fall asleep, right? And there's a lot of strategies. I've seen most of them over the years. I've used most of them over the years. But if you are teaching through writing, or through making TV programs, you are not coterminous. And not being coterminous means telling people things becomes odd, right? Telling people things, you don't know whether they'll get it. And so one of the things that we often talked about was building in spaces of pause and reflection and saying, you know, we said that, do you believe that? Is that how it works for you? And it meant writing in a slightly more, I don't want to do telling you that this was good practice. I think we struggled with it. But it was writing as if there might be a person who might look puzzled, go, I don't think so. So it had spaces in it. And I think that changes the writing style. So that's one of the influences on me, which is I feel I should tell you that I'm doing this for a reason, and that you might not quite believe me, and you might just go and sod it, and throw the thing into the car. But the other one is Stuart Hall and Cultural Studies, which is, it's no good having a theory of articulation, which you do at arm's length analytically. The practice is also about articulation, is about building points of connection and identification. So it does, all right, so I'll tell you can I tell you my story? So I'm sitting in an Open University meeting. I've been there for 28 years at this point. It must be a bit less, 25 years. And it's a meeting of academic faculty to talk about the plan for the new undergraduate introduction to social sciences, which all the different disciplines are going to contribute to. there's two stumbling blocks in this conversation. I mean, I'm about six undergraduate introduction to social sciences were made during my time, so I knew enough about what the stumbling blocks were. One is economics, of course, because economics is different. It certainly is, but, you know. And even with nice heterodox economists, economics is difficult. But the other one, recurrently, was psychology. Because at least large parts of academic psychology do not do the social. So, cognitive psychology, behavioral psychology, there's a whole set of things that don't do the social. And the eminent professor of psychology sat in this meeting saying, it's all very well doing interdisciplinary work, but we need parts of this course that are going to be about the individual. At which point, because I'm a depressive, as you know, my heart sank, and I thought, I've been in 20 of these meetings. I can't do this again. I need to walk away. At which point, I heard Stuart say, who was also at the meeting, you're absolutely right. Okay. Then perk up, yeah. Take a lively interest in this moment. And he said, he sort of leant in. He said, I do think that it's a really important focus for the course, and I don't think we've done it enough in the past. And he proceeded to give 10 reasons why we should focus on the individual, to which the professor of psychology was nodding, delighted to have an ally, delighted to have a friend in a room full of social people, right? And Stuart is a man of immense personal charm as well as intellectual smart. So it was a lovely moment. And he then said, we're agreed, we could commit to writing about the individual in this course and all these things that we should be doing with it. And then we won't be going back to the abstract, isolated, individual that psychology thinks historically in terms of. We will be looking forward to the nature of the individualization of the individual. And it was an example for me of you do it. An articulation is both. You enroll people into the solidarity. And the bit that I'd never thought about before was, and you cut off the retreat. Right? So you have forged the collective commitment. And there is no going back. Right? You can't fall back to that older position, which we all, don't we all? All us modern thinkers agree is discredited. And it was just, I came out of it awestruck. Right? And I shouldn't be awestruck, because I'd known him for, I don't know, 30 years by then. So I shouldn't have been, but it was just, which is awestruck, much loved, and oh God, right? There are some things about setting standards that the rest of us don't quite keep up with. Right?
I'm sorry, Agnes, I have to speak at my meeting, and I wish I could stay.
Apparently, there's going to be a recording.
So I should just maybe check in around that. It's about 10 to 5, and we have the better part of an hour of video. Okay. So are there particular questions that people really want to get to?
Well, maybe you guys jump in, because that's quite pressing. But maybe you could speak to what the younger scholars that you know, who are perhaps in a more precarious or risky position than you, how do they negotiate the kinds of individualism and sort of the individual eye and expertise that you problematize in that chapter? So can you just
talk about the noise?
that's an okay question for as a way to wrap up. You kind of survive and not totally lose your integrity.
Yeah.
I mean, I will, but.
I'm going to interrupt for a second and just ask the question again so that it's on camera.
Okay, that's fine.
Sorry. Yeah, cool. That's great. Okay, super. And I'm going to just actually, will you pull that blind down? Because every time I film you, you look vaguely like you're either on fire or or a saint, maybe. Okay.
It's always been a good look.
Never been compared to a saint before.
There you go.
Okay, so a final question. In the chapter, you're arguing for a dialogical practice, which would be massively time-consuming. Proximity is required, ways of staying in contact over years and years, in ways that are not typically supported by the contemporary structure of the academy, even to romanticize the past, which is kind of questionable when it comes to the university. So could you talk about how younger folks that are precariously connected to the university navigate the kind of the individualism that you're concerned about and therefore writing against in the chapter?
I can, but with a sort of big qualification, which is I am out of time in the sense that I mean, I joked about not being a role model earlier, and I'm not, because I don't have a repertoire either of skills or of knowledge which are about surviving this conjuncture, this configuration of things. So it's a sort of second-hand reflection on what the people I know who talk to me about these things talk to me about. And I think, the first thing to say is I think they're incredibly heavily pressed upon, because the combination of competitiveness and precarity and the fetishization of individual performance, it's not that those things weren't around when I was a lad, but cultural studies, at least, and one or two other places, had practices for doing things differently. I think the space for those practices has been squeezed in important ways. So one of the things that I discovered, and which gives me pause for thought in response to this question, is there's a way in which old people like myself turn a good practice of 40 years ago into moral injunctions. Right? You should do collaborative working. Well, I've now decided that that's not the most helpful contribution I can make, because in cultural studies especially, we should know that conjunctures change. And that a moral injunction that might have made sense in 1972, in my case, might need to be rethought and refined in 2018. It might need more care and attention than us old folk sometimes give it. So that's all a big qualifying set of things. So the ones that I know have a number of complicated strategies for surviving, coping, resisting. Some of them are about not letting this be the only world they inhabit. So a lot of people I know and admire have mixed their academic work with, I don't know, varieties of voluntary activist involvement in places outside but connected to it. I mean, so if I think about lots of migrant solidarity movements, lots of anti-domestic violence movements that both intersect with the academic work but mean it's not the only place those questions are being conducted. And that generates other solidarities that mean you can go home and go out and go, oh, I can't tell you how bad the university is. The other is that I think there are some places that foster not collaborative working in the sense that I think about it, but a more communal sensibility and spaces within which the interests, experiences and concerns are collectively reflected upon. I mean, often patchily, and it doesn't make the stuff go away, but it does allow, when I was a young person, C. Wright Mills was very important and talked about the translation of private troubles into public issues. And one of the things that I think is important is about stopping these experiences, these systemic features being lived as private, or lived only as private troubles. Right? So I did a workshop recently with PhD students in CEU, and depressed all of them massively. But one of the things that was at stake was saying, you know, it was about workshop about writing and the consequences of writing, like getting comments from journals and things, should not be an experience of private misery. Right? And so, because it usually is, right? It usually is. You get comments back on whether it's an essay, whether it's a submission to a journal or whatever. Reviewer two says, you have not done this, you need to do that, and they've got a better reading list than you've got. I've had to think about this over the years, because I am astonishingly bad at taking such comments. When I was in employment, I used to be found walking down the corridor, kicking the wall and swearing, right? Outraged at the stupidity, arrogance, and bloody academics. And I think there are structural flaws to the reviewing process, so that's fine. And so I was encouraging my young colleagues at CEU, I've known over some years, to find ways of making communal some of these experiences. So I said, if you don't think you take feedback very well, do what I used to advise my department to do back at the Open University, which is have somebody else read it. Have somebody else read it and tell you what it says. Because you won't make sense of it. So I shared an office with somebody who got feedback on a journal article, and she ranted about it. She was so upset. And I said, can I have a look? Because I'm a nice person, obviously. And I read it, and I said, no, it would drive me crazy. I said, but it does say at the bottom, we will be delighted to publish your article. And she said, it says what? And so I used this as testimony to, it's a good idea to get somebody else to read through it. Because I know that I get so, I got some feedback on an article recently which said, this doesn't make enough use of Clark's work on...
Amazing.
Because you anonymise for journal submissions, so I'd have to take all the Clark stuff out. Right? And I thought, oh dear God, I'm just going to shoot myself.
You're like, why did you give me this? How do I respond to this?
So I guess, I mean, the people at CEU say, so... Your main message, as we understand it, is to make friends. And actually, it's what they do, because I know that they do some of those things in common. Not the whole, sometimes the whole group, sometimes two or three of them. Different things in different combinations, but they have started strategies. So I saw two of the women in the group afterwards, at the next meeting that we were both going to, and I I said, "Son, I was there." And I said, "We were just talking about it. It was very depressing." And then one of them laughed at me and said, "But we are talking to one another about it and about how depressed we are. So we have learned the basic Clark lesson." Mm-hmm. And I think people find those things. I think they should be better supported institutionally in the spaces and times for doing that. I think old people should try to be helpful rather than be directive. I mean, instead of embodying and enacting the model, I think they should, you know, try and create breathing spaces. So those are about, I mean, I'm sure there's lots more. As you know, I can go on for days about any of these things. But the thing about how you live the relations across the institutional boundary so that everything does not fold into this rather strange space and its investments and bizarre effects. I mean, we should have another talk sometime about the strangeness of the space. But the other is about finding friends, and it can be called all sorts of dignified names like collectivizing and so on.
We just have a book club, but yeah.
Well, there you go. But anything that stops it being the individual in the individual cell suffering. Because they're miserable processes. I don't know whether you enjoy writing or not, but I certainly, after 40-something years, it's painful. Physically and emotionally, it's painful. And I got shortcuts. There are shortcuts to coping with some of this, but it's not turned into a life-enhancing and rewarding experience. It's hinted at in that chapter. Academics are strange about telling themselves stories about why we do it. Mm-hmm. Right? I am currently committed only to writing as therapy. Mm-hmm. Right? I am angry and upset about Brexit, mm-hmm. and so I've written loads about Brexit because mm-hmm. it's a way of not wandering around my local town and hitting people. Right? Though politically, I may have made the wrong choice here. I've run out of...
The human is appreciated in this institution.
Good.
So thank
it
you
needs
very
to
much.
Be. Oh, thank you. That was a lot of fun.
That was